in the Global South Green Technology Packages. That included modern varieties, fertilizers, pesticides, and irrigation. The high cost of these purchase inputs deepened the divide between large farmers and smallholder farmers because the latter could not afford the technology. In both Mexico and India, seminal studies revealed that the Green Revolution's expensive packages favored a minority of economically privileged farmers and put the majority of smallholder farmers at a disadvantage and led to the concentration of land and resources. So anytime Agra comes up and talks about the Green Revolution and how it's going to benefit Ghanaian farmers, I think the first thing we should ask them is that what are the inputs or what exactly does it comprise of? And will our small-scale farmers be able to compete in the purchase of these pesticides and the new varieties of seeds they are bringing and the systems around which this whole, you know, Green Revolution is being organized? Can our farmers, our small-scale farmers, in Sabalugu, in Nyampandrui, in Kumasi, in Bibien, would they be able to match the kind of inputs that the Green Revolution is introducing? And if not, who are the beneficiaries of this Green Revolution? It can be our smallholder farmers. Now, over time, Green Revolution technologies degrade tropical ecosystems and expose already vulnerable farmers to increased environmental risks. Following the early socioeconomic failures, governments started subsidizing the Green Revolution packages in an effort to encourage adoption by smallholders. In areas where smallholder farmers did adopt the package, the spread of modern varieties greatly increased the use of pesticides and fertilizers, often with serious health, environmental, and economic consequences. Now, the Green Revolution leads to loss of agro-biodiversity, the basis for smallholder livelihood security, and regional environmental sustainability. Diversity is an important nutritional resource of poor communities, but the spread of modern varieties was accompanied by loss of local crop varieties and a trend towards monoculture, which reduced dietary diversity and increased malnutrition. Hunger is not primarily due to lack of food, and must stress this, but rather because the hungry are too poor to buy the food that is available. Nobel laureate Amartya Sen has shown that farming is fundamentally a problem of democracy, poverty, and food distribution. While the architects of Agra dutifully recite the Green Revolution's often trumpeted claims to success in raising agricultural yields, there is little understanding of the causes of hunger or the Green Revolution's colossal failures. It did not effectively reduce poverty or hunger. Without addressing structural inequities in the market and political systems, approaches relying on high input technologies fail. The growing hunger in Africa is largely due to the increased impoverishment of the very rural peoples who once grew food, but who have now left farming. Today's African farmers could easily produce far more food than they do, but they don't because they cannot get credit to cover production costs, nor can they find buyers or obtain fair prices to give them a minimum profit margin. Under such circumstances, what difference would a new technology package make without addressing the causes of why African farmers are leaving farming or why they underproduce? Agra will have little impact on this trend. And here, let us not forget of the havoc that mining is causing in many farming communities in our country. Many farmers are leaving their farms simply because, with the connivance of our parliament and the executive of our country, huge tracts of lands have been given over to foreign multinational corporations who are mining on these lands that once was used by farmers to produce the food that we eat. So in absence of food, some of them are running into Galamsey or they're running to Accra to find jobs which are non-existent. These are the challenges confronting our country. We must rise up and ask ourselves appropriate questions. Now, the private sector alone will not solve the problems of production, marketing, and distribution. The Green Revolution was introduced through the massive institutional support systems of the Indian and Mexican development states. Government agricultural ministries provided training, credit, research, and extension, marketing, processing, and distribution services to farmers who adopted green revolution technology. These heavy state subsidies created a market for private sector entry into the seed, fertilizer, machinery, and trade activities in the green revolution. Few of these services are remotely available today, and the evidence is there everywhere this initiative has been carried out. Introduction of genetic engineering, the driving force behind AGRES initiative, will make smallholder systems more environmentally vulnerable in sub-Saharan Africa. AGRES directors openly admit that their conventional crop breeding approaches will pave the way for genetic engineering technology. Both the Gates and the Rockefeller Foundations are actively financing projects in genetic engineering. However, genetic engineering increases the risk of environmental failure on smallholder farms. The expansion of transgenic maize and soybeans monocultures in Africa will not only narrow the genetic base of indigenous agriculture, but will also cause environmental risks. There are many widely accepted environmental risks associated with the rapid deployment and widespread commercialization of genetically engineered crops. The introduction of genetically engineered crops into smallholder agriculture will likely lead to farmer indebtedness. The expansion of GE crops in the global south is driven by powerful transnational corporations that, in the face of growing public rejection of GM crops, foods in the industrialized world are desperately attempting to expand their markets in the global south. Now, there is a lot of evidence in India to support this. Where Indian farmers are now coming to realize that the promise of GM crops or GE crops, helping them to control pests and also increasing yield, has not been the story. They are finding that with the use of BT cotton, which was supposed to help them solve the problem of particular, worms which were destroying their cotton, new kinds of worms are now coming into their cultivation of crops, and this is leading to a decreased yield in their harvest. And this is why we must question the rationale behind all of these initiatives that have been pushed on Africa. AGRES assertion that there is no alternative ignores many successful agroecological and non-corporate approaches to agricultural development that have grown in the wake of the Green Revolution's failures. Truly, developing and reducing hunger requires policy changes that are far more important than technology fixes. To use crude economics language, we could say that any supply side that are assist in fertilizers approach is useless until demand side are resolved. Now let's look at the opportunities, and then I'll bring my presentation to a close. We already know what to do. The final report of the International Assessment of Agricultural Science and Technology had recommendations which continue to receive confirmation each time there is some independent study on Africa's agricultural needs. The agrochemicals and biotechnology industry were obviously unhappy with the conclusions in the IAASTD report. They withdrew from the process before the final meeting with claims that industry perspectives, particularly its view that GM crops are key to reducing poverty and hunger, were not adequately reflected in the report. The report's lack of specific support for GM crops was, however, based on a rigorous and peer-reviewed analysis of the empirical evidence. After consideration of the evidence on both sides of the debate, the report is notably muted in relation to the claimed benefits of GM crops, highlighting instead the lingering doubts and uncertainties surrounding them. For poor farmers, the report concludes GM crops are unlikely to play a substantial role in addressing their needs. In the case, longer-term assessments of the environmental and health risks and regulatory frameworks are needed. Another key concern highlighted in relation to GM crops is the dominance of the biotechnology industry in agricultural research and development, and at the expense of other agricultural sciences. Furthermore, the report noted that farmers face new liabilities from GM crops, particularly as a result of the detection of GM crops in conventional and organic crops that leads to patent infringement suits and loss of certification, respectively. The way forward is a very simple one. It is one of low input, agroecological, sustainable agriculture. The onslaught they have unleashed must create new opportunities for solidarity, and it is already happening. A quick glance at this call will confirm that. Thank you so much for coming.
We have had two wonderful presentations, one from state and one from the table. I think they deserve more than what you are doing. Thank you, Duke. I think it's a useful point for us. It's a useful point to have a break, a coffee break, for 30 minutes. We are not going outside. Everything has been arranged here. So you kindly walk to the table and replenish your energy so that when you come back, we'll continue with the session. When we come back, we have a period for discussion. So whatever questions that you have, please put them down for either state or for your table. We will have time for questions and for comments. So ladies and gentlemen, we are breaking now for a 30 minutes coffee and tea break. Thank you. Thank you.